House of Fraser in trouble. So what does this mean? What is going to happen to the high street in 10 years' time? Where will we be? Now, of course, our city centre manager is Johnny Noble. He works for the council. He's the man in charge of developing our city centre. And he's been at a conference in that there London today talking about this with all sorts of different people. And we've managed to get him on the line. Hi, Johnny.
Hiya, Peg. Afternoon.
Yeah, hiya. I can't hear loads and loads of noisy, hooting traffic in the background. Shouldn't
not
you be having that when you're down there? Are the streets beneath you shimmering with gold?
You'd like to think so, if we believe everything we read in the press, but not quite, to be quite honest. A bit of an eye-opener in parts.
Yeah. I mean, that's the thing. I always get quite... Because I kind of have this imagination now that everywhere in London is just super uber swish and swanky. And actually, you go to some areas and it's not had that regeneration and development, has it? The streets are not quite paved in gold. I heard a report recently that said actually a lot of places in the south are faring far worse than we are in the north, actually, when it comes to this high street. So tell us about these conversations you've been having today around the high street.
Yeah, it was a bit of a get-together between a number of interested parties in the High Street. So it was the Institute of Place Management, the BID Foundation and the Association of Town and City Management, all three independent of each other, but all realising that, you know, we've got some serious challenges. We've already gone through some significant upheaval on the High Street, and it's not going to get any better going forward, particularly for retail. And it was very much about how, as a collective, we can get together, point out some of the key concerns from all over the country and have a collective response to go to government and say, look, you know, what can you do to help with the High Street? What are your thoughts on the High Street? Is the High Street a priority? If it isn't a priority, how are we going to address this slide? Obviously, there's lots of very big things going on, such as Brexit, to use just one example. And the High Street seems to really be slipping off radars, and we can't allow that to happen.
Yeah, I mean, it says, you know, some people do say that basically all civil servants who are any good have been moved off anything and they're working on Brexit at the moment, and there is nothing else happening at government level. I mean, it does feel like there is potentially, I don't want to use the word crisis, because maybe this is just one of these things where things are changing.
Yeah. And
does it need to be a crisis? Doesn't it need to be a crisis? I don't know. But what we know is for sure is that things are changing, and that very much our cities, our towns, our economies are built around the idea of the high street. And if that's changing, we've got to put something else in its place, because you could see in Bradford what happens when that just kind of falls to the wayside.
Mm. I mean, obviously, looking at the national picture, you're looking at major retailers. Retail is changing. We know about online shopping, that goes without saying. We know about shopping habits. We know about people much maybe prefer to sit at home and order it and get it delivered. We need to make the whole thing an experience. So rather than just going into a shop and buying, I don't know, a pair of shoes, there's got to be an experience with that. It's got to be an enjoyable experience, the look and feel, speaking to people, actually having that human interaction and adding to it. So if retail's not going to be the answer, if that's the right phrase, what else do we add? So we look at leisure, we look at hospitality, we look at a destination, we look at the city centre to become a destination to go to, and retail forms part of that. But can it be a bigger picture? Can we go down, we have something to eat, we have something to drink, we do some shopping, we go to the...
So that's where, for Bradford, things like our Curry Capital status, our City of Film status, all those kind of things, become all the more important, don't they?
Yeah, I mean, just look at the city centre, what we've got in the city centre. I think we forget sometimes just how spoilt we are with the National Science and Media Museum, the Alhambra, the soon-to-be-refurbished and reopened St George's Hall, City Park, Sunbridge Wells, North Parade, and then everything that links it in between. We've got, obviously, the Broadway Shopping Centre and the Kirkgate Shopping Centre. And it's those gaps that we can see are emerging. And if you're a retailer and you look at, and I'll use Darley Street as an example, if you look at some of the units up on Darley Street, are they going to invest a significant amount of money to bring them up to spec and bring them up to date? Is that ever going to happen? And if it's not, then we look at alternative uses for that space. And, you know, we've got to be thinking differently. We've got to be thinking much more cleverly.
Yeah.
Footfall across the whole of the country is down. There's no denying it. And people are feeling the pinch. And it tends to be the independents and the smaller businesses that really, that basically struggle to survive. I mean, business rates, the whole business rates review and the cost of business rates, it's a huge barrier to getting to business before you even unlock a door. So, you know, do a look at business rates. How can we, and the city centre growth zone, the business rates funds that the council have been providing for the last 4 or 5 years, I think it is now, have created, you know, hundreds of jobs, dozens and dozens of new businesses, and it is seen as an exemplar. But it's still, you know, we can give business rate rebates till we're blue faced. The issue being is if people are going in and spending money, and they're not dwelling, and they're not in, you know, in particularly retail I'm talking about now. Mm. You know, what is it, are we using that money to the best? So do we need to look at different uses?
That's a massive challenge for you as city centre manager. It's a huge challenge, as you say, it's also a challenge for politicians. It's a challenge for government to say, you know, because economies are kind of built on it. And for Bradford, it's an even bigger challenge, I think, because the city was so focused for so many years on just getting that Broadway centre built. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. Wasn't it? Everything for so long was just, I've got to get Broadway built, which was all about building another shopping centre. And now we're saying, actually, do you know what? Maybe we've got to look at this whole thing in a completely different way. That's hard for people to get their heads around.
It is, and I mean, obviously, the Broadway was desperately needed. We've brought in, I think it's 80% of the units in there are new to the city centre, and I don't think there's any secret in the fact that the Marks and Spencers building up on Darley Street was probably not what they would want as one of their outlets. So obviously, they're an anchor tenant now in the Broadway. So, you know, it's no surprise that Darley Street, people relocate from Darley Street. It's what we do with it now, and obviously, there's proposals for relocation of the market. That
and innovative stuff, the food court ideas and that, you know, the pop-up stuff, and I think it's all those kind of, as you say, looking at it differently. I mean, off the subject, but people talking about some of the stores that are going down, are partly because they didn't understand the shopping experience as opposed to just shopping, and so much of this stuff is going to be about the experience, isn't it?
And I think I kicked off earlier on using that very word, experience. It's got to be, and this is where we need to be upskilling people through Skills House and getting the World Horse training, which adds to the customer experience. You know, no longer are people going to put up with bad customer service. There's absolutely no chance, and quite rightly so. So upskilling people with World Horse training and making them job ready and customer focused, and realising the importance of an interaction with a member of the public has to be a good experience for a member of the public, otherwise they won't come back to your
Why
place.
Are they going to pay more when you can get it online?
Get it online less. From the comfort of your own house.
You offer people that experience. And Maplin, the electronics firm, I mean, that's very much what they've found, isn't it? That part of the reason people are saying is because they just didn't, you know, the staff weren't able to give the help that people would want to make it worthwhile going into the store.
I mean, it's so easy using Maplin as an example to get everything there and more besides that they sold online at a fraction of the cost delivered directly. And and that's how we need to change. That's how we need to rethink retail. Let's look at hospitality. Let's look at leisure. Let's look at alternative uses, meanwhile uses, pop-ups, incubation spaces. And let's face the fact that retail is going to shrink. So what's going to take its place? Is it going to be accommodation? Is it going to be housing?
Yeah.
Is it going to be, like, let's say, hospitality, leisure? So, you know, there's so much to debate on it, and we could probably talk all evening.
We could talk about it. I'm going to ask you a question that you're probably going to tell me you can't answer, Johnny, okay?
You might
say, because obviously you're an officer for the council, but some of this stuff you're talking about, I do wonder sometimes whether politicians have the imagination and the ability to see alternative futures to be able to make the hard decisions that would be needed in order to kind of actually make some of these changes.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think that there's a lack of vision or a lack of ambition at all. I think we've got to be realistic, and, you know, there's not an infinite amount of money out there, and we've got to cut the cloth to suit, and decisions are very, very difficult to make in the current climate when you're talking about, you know, budget allocation to adults and children's services and things like that. You know, there's statutory services that we need to protect. I don't think it's a lack of imagination or ambition. We've got to live in the real world at times, and I think some of the decisions that have been made, obviously, such as the backing of the Odeon, that in itself, with the evening and nighttime economy as it is in the city centre, is a huge boost to the evening and nighttime economy. And obviously, you can have 3,000-4,000 people in there on a Friday or a Saturday night that'll need somewhere to eat and drink.
It all adds up, doesn't it?
Every piece of the jigsaw, definitely.
Definitely. Well, listen, I'm sure we will keep talking about it, but it's been really fascinating. As you say, we could talk about this for ages and ages.
Absolutely.
But you've got streets of gold to walk down in Blackburn, London.